Okay, so now just to give you a recap, we are going to look at the land use and the planning strategy. Okay, so we just did a quick understanding of what is the land use situation prior to 1975 and after that. So now we know that the land use pattern that existed before 1975, this is how it looked. We did a review of it and what happened to the land use pattern as per the first master plan. Also, we have a clarity over here. We also compared the percentages of the various land uses where the changes happened. Okay, so we understood from the from these two tabular columns that there were a lot of problems that were faced by the CMDA in implementing the first master plan zoning at DCR. So now, if you have to look at after the what happened after the first master plan, we can let us understand that there were a lot of reclassification of land uses based on the request from the landowners. Okay, so based on the number of reclassifications, there were a lot of there were changes in the status of the particular land, for example, city, municipality, town panchayat and panchayat unit. So from the year 1977 to the year 2004, so that is when the first master plan came to a closing, that is in 2005. So here you can see how the total number of units have changed across the years. So from a 20 in 1982, it topped to 55, the number of panchayat units, unions. Cities, from 17, it reduced to 14, which means the area would have increased. Okay, so that is how the classification took place. So here you can see a reclassification tabular column in CMA from Jan 1977 to Feb 2005, that is the tenure of the first master plan. So here you can see a split up that is put over here. Now let us focus on DCR. Now we know that DCR, give a lot of impetus to DCR when we start to design. Okay, so any built area or any project that requires design, we first sit with the development control rules or the DCR. Now the main purpose of the DCR, which was actually absent before the first master plan, before 1977, they understood that there were a lot of loopholes. So the main purpose of the development control rules or the development control regulation was to ensure that the buildings are built keeping in mind these aspects: achieving optimum utilization of land within the infrastructure levels in an area, whether it is in an existing, proposed or planned infrastructure level within the planned period. So utilizing the land in an optimum way was a prime criteria. Adequate natural lighting and ventilation for healthy living. Okay, within the desired planned density of population, that's thereby preventing negative social, economic, environmental impacts of high densities. So a particular desired or planned density of population were to be maintained, and open spaces on ground to improve the urban environment, with adequate space for parking within the plot. aesthetics and taking into requirements of urban design aspects such as solids, voids, views, etc. With aspects of safety, convenience, and economy, the DCR also kept a reasonable limit for that. And also with no or minimal negative externalities on the adjoining buildings and uses. So when you propose a new project, a building or a built area, it was to be made sure that there is no negative externalities on the building adjacent to the proposed building. The development regulations were also used as a tool to encourage amalgamation of smaller sites into larger ones for achieving a higher FSI. We know that FSI is a floor space index with provision of adequate space around the buildings and for recreational purposes within the site, and also to discourage overutilization of road and other infrastructure, resulting in congestion, traffic delay, choking, and breaking down of water supply, sewerage, or electricity infrastructures. Development standards prescribed for building constructions vary from country to country, region to region, city to city, for the reason of local climatic conditions and public infrastructure, that is the macro climate, micro climate, availability, terrain, culture, way of life of the people, affordability, and also the availability of land for a particular development. Prior to 1975, that is before the master plan by CMA came into force, the building constructions were regulated by the Tamil Nadu District Municipality Building Rules, Tamil Nadu Panchayat Building Rules. Now, after the first master plan came into existence, the rules and regulations concerning building constructions were entirely monitored by the CMDA or the CMA. Okay, now let us look at a few very important aspects which comes under the DCR, that is density and FSI. Now we know that Chennai is one of the highly populated cities in India. Okay, being a metropolitan city, the density is quite high. Density varies from 180 persons per hectare in Saidapet and Mylapore corporation zones and 368 persons per hectare in Kodambakkam zone within the corporation limit, and the gross density for Chennai city is 247 persons per hectare. Now, this simply means that 247 people are put up in 1 hectare of land area. Okay. And FSI is a tool that is used in urban planning to regulate the densities, of population with reference to infrastructure provision. Density of population needs to be regulated for various reasons like carrying capacity of the infrastructure, sociological reasons, crime rate, physical factors, etc. The prevalence of high density in Chennai is due to the following reasons: smaller lot sizes, smaller dwelling unit sizes, larger family, on an average of 4.5 against that of 2.5 in USA and other Western countries. And after the first master plan, which was wrapped up in 2005, then came the 2006 onwards, the second master plan, where the land use pattern has been found in the following manner as put in the tabular column here. Residential 54%, commercial 7%, institutional 18%, other areas put together under vacant, forest, hills, low-lying, etc. to 12%. And here you can see in the rest of the CMA, this is only for the Chennai city, you can see that the other areas top the list with 54%. Residential comes then with a 21.87%. That is the existing one. Then came the proposed land use for 2026, that is by the end of the second master plan. From 54 for Chennai city, the residential zone was planned for 33%, and from 21% for the rest of CMA, it was planned for 31.68%. And let us see. So the others also, that is the roads, water bodies, hills, catchment area, forest, tuned up to 21.31%. So you can see that a primary residential and the other areas, which is actually the roads and the water bodies, open spaces, etc. And also taking a look at the rest of CMA, also you can find that the primary residential use zone, top the list with 31.68, and others top, the other like roads, water bodies, hills, etc., was like around 27.79%. So that is the drastic change that you see in the land use pattern for 2006 and 2026. And let us take a quick look at the population density in select cities in the world. In India, if we take a look at Mumbai city density per hectare is 212, compared to that of 216 for Chennai. And for Delhi, it is a 258 packs per hectare. Kolkata is 248, Chennai is 247. So we see that Kolkata tops the list with a population high of density of 248 per hectare. So we have a clarity on the role of DCR, the land use planning, what is land use planning, why is land use planning important, etc. Now let us take a look at the basics of the land use planning. Okay, so let us take a look at land use planning. Okay. Okay, so here we are. What is land use? Land use refers to the manner of utilization of land, including its allocation, development, and management. So basically, that is the simplest definition for land use. Now, why do we put emphasis on land use? Municipal governments divide the land into various pockets in order for an urban area to function effectively and to meet all the needs of citizens. It also involves the management and modification of natural environment or wilderness into built environments such as fields, pastures, and settlements. So let us understand the objectives of land use planning. So we can put it down like this: to promote efficient utilization, acquisition, and disposition of land and ensure the highest and best use of land, number one. Two, to direct harmonize, influence discussions and activities of the private and public sectors relative to the use and management of land. To reconcile land use conflicts and proposals between and among individuals, private and government entities relative to the present and future need for the land. Also, an objective of land use is to promote desirable patterns of land uses to prevent wasteful development and minimize the cost of public infrastructure, utility, and other social services. To preserve areas of ecological, aesthetic, historical, and cultural significance. So these are the objectives behind land use planning. Now, based on the type of land use, it has been classified as residential, commercial, institutional, industrial, transportation, utilities and facilities, open spaces, greens, etc. Now, residential, let us look, go into the details of each classification. Residential, as you know, it talks about low density, single family homes, semi-detached homes, duplex, medium density, that is a townhouse, the low-rise apartments, and high density, that is the high-rise apartments. So that is essentially the residential zone or the residential land use. Commercial is the land that is set aside for commercial activities, as the name says, includes any land that is used for buying, selling, trading goods and services. And category includes all types of wholesale, retail and service activities serving large areas that is larger than the neighborhood. And also it includes the types of wholesale, retail and service activities. The major central business districts in urbanized areas like shopping service area with largest department and variety stores, specialty shops, business and professional services, hotels, theaters, etc. Minor central business district in less urbanized areas, market as main feature types, wholesale market, wet and dry market, mixed use development, commercial strips such as highway, gas station, motel and restaurant, extension of CBD, neighborhood centers, etc. And institutional land use. This covers the major public and semi-public uses like educational, cultural, religious, health, protective, and government services. It is also included of schools, hospitals, government offices, and places of worship. Industrial land use is the land that is used for industry, such as factories, warehouses, power plants, or places of resource extraction like mines or a quarry. It includes manufacturing, refining, fabricating, assembly, storage, parking, and other incidental uses including food processing, cottage industry, sawmill, rice mill, steel mill, chemical processing plant, etc. And also, the proposed industrial estate subdivisions are also included in this. Transportation is the land that is used for moving people, goods from one place to another, as the name goes. Sidewalks, roads, highways, subways, steel cars, railroads, tracks, freight yards, airports, marinas, any other land that is used for transportation. Open spaces and greens, land that is now vacant or left in natural state, like in a woodlot or a forest, or a land that is for recreational use, parks, playgrounds, community centers, etc. And the space requirement may be computed with the use of space standards based on population or the area of the municipality or city. The non-functional open spaces are the ones that is reserved or set aside for green belts, buffer zones, or any other specific functional purpose. So let us try to summarize what is land use planning. It is the rational and correct approach of allocating available land resources to different land using activities and for different functions consistent with the overall development vision goal of a particular city. And it varies from city to city. refers to a document. Land use planning document refers to a document embodying a set of policies accompanied by maps and similar illustrations which represent the community desired pattern of population distribution and a proposal for the future allocation of land to the various land using activities. Now, what are the various principles that is used in the process of land use planning? One is to evaluate and record the unique features, preserve the unique cultural or historical features, conserve open space and environmental features, calculate additional charges for altering land, plan for mixed uses in close proximity, plan variety of transportation options, set limits and manage growth pattern, encourage development in areas of existing infrastructure. Now, there is something called land use map or mapping. Land use map is a graphical representation of land use for a place or a particular in an area. It is a convenient visual form of spatial data, the distribution and relationships. This is a reduced and simplified model of reality containing geographic information. It is a graphic representation of all or part of a geographic realm where the real world features have been replaced with symbols in the correct spatial location at a reduced scale. Now let us see what makes the elements of a land use map. There goes a map title, a legend, a date and author, north arrow, geographic coordinates, latitude, longitude, scale, graphic scale, numerical, functional, etc. Now, map title defines the information and the purpose of map. Legend is the key to the codes and the symbols used in a map, and so on. What are the concepts of land use? Reversible uses, irreversible uses, multiple land use, compatible or incompatible land use, best use of land, comprehensive land use plan, and the physical, social, economic, and environmental planning. Now, this is how a land use map looks like. You can see that there are various color codes used to represent certain type of land use. Yellow goes for residential, red for commercial, purple for industrial, blue for institutional, light green oasis, green for parks. That's a dark oasis, light oasis, or grass color for agriculture, light indigo for agro-industrial, dark green or bottle green for forest, brown for mining and quarry. So this is how the classification and the color coordination that goes onto a land use map. So let us have a look at, this is for you to understand now to depth. Let us, it would be quite interesting to see the land use map for Chennai. Okay, so here we go. Now this is the land use, proposed land use plan for the second master plan up to 2026. That is from 2006 to 2026 for a period of 20 years. So here it's very clear for you. You can see very clearly. I'm gonna first show you the the map title, the north. Okay, now here you can see the color codes, yellow for the residential, and you can see that's the majority of the color is yellow, blue for commercial, and you can see the water bodies, the forest areas. Okay, so this gives you a clarity as to how the land use pattern is, has evolved over a period of time and what is, how is it segregated, how, what is the pattern, and how the residential zones are spread out across, etc. Okay, so this is how the land use planning for the second master plan has been approached, and this is how it is now. So this is a